I can't believe it, folks. We had 160,000 people live on our show on Wednesday. Oh, maybe 16,000. Or anyway, there's lots of people. But today, it's a Thursday evening. And I think Thursday evening is the day of sharing for all of us. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to share something beautiful. And it's yours. It's my gift. I'm not going to keep it. I'm going to just give it to you. Now, my wife's in Hyderabad. That's not my gift. In a way, it is my gift because she's in Hyderabad. So early in the morning, couldn't find my footwear. So I just found her sandals in the dark. Take the dogs down under five. That's me. Only and me and Baba Ramdev were up at that time for various reasons, both in similar clothing. I got up and I just put on her sandals because I didn't want to waste time. And I went down. And I must tell you, it was the most comfortable experience of my life. Which brings me to my point. I think we made too much about sexist clothing, that you have to define your clothing with a sex or gender. I think that's absolutely stupid. I'm going to try skirts also. I mean, I'm going to do it at home first. But I'm just thinking, because I don't like anything holding me tight. I've never liked underwear, for example. So I think we've got to break this mold now, get out of it, you know, start thinking a little differently, because it's not right. We shouldn't be so fixated gender-wise that we, and it doesn't question your sexuality to try clothes that make you feel happy and comfortable, like the sandals did. Please, never tell my wife I wore her sandals. She's very aggressive about sharing things. And if she finds out, all that will be left are the sandals. Okay, let's welcome on our show two living legends, Amit and Silvery. Again, I do not lie. I exaggerate sometimes, but I'm not much of a liar. I must tell you, female sandals are really comfortable. Why didn't I think of this before? They're much more comfortable than the stupid rubber slippers I've been wearing every day. When nails go inside and they keep slipping from my, you know, in the rain and all, you slip a lot. These grip better. They have some sort of nice rubber sole. And the top was more balanced. The heel felt better. I even looked like I had money for the first time in my life.
How are your feet not squashed, though? How are your feet not squashed?
What gets squashed?
How are your feet not squashed in the
Are you
shoes?
Calling my wife a fatso with big fat feet?
No, I'm saying she's thin. So how are your feet not squashed?
I've got really small feet, or she's got really big feet. So one of us is going down on this one. Okay, there's no way out. This is what my Gujarati friends call the Titanic. Huh? It's going to go down.
I'm saying the other way around. I'm saying you will probably have bigger feet than your wife, so she will.
Your sandals where you basically. It's a little fancy. I'll have to show them to you now. They're up. You hold with the toes like Roman sandals. You just hold with the toes and it's wide enough. It's wide enough. It's all open. There's just one thing on top. So, in fact, it fits. I would say, don't tell her. She never watches. It fits me better than it fits. So, I'm telling you, honestly, if I had to put my feet up and model them, you put my foot and her foot and now both our feet are equally hairy, you will immediately say that Brocha's foot, as in mine, is better. But listen, under all this, my point is very serious. I think we made too much out of wearing this male gender sort of clothing and female gender sort of clothing. I think that's stupid. Look at the Scots. They love that.
May I ask a question?
Yes, please.
When was the last time you bought a new pair of sandals?
I never buy clothes or sandals. That's my point.
That's an issue. You wear this ill-fitting shit that all these all these shoots give you, and then
finally,
you don't.
Silvery, finally, he couldn't take it anymore. He's like that cousin of yours who, you know, finally couldn't take it anymore. He's been civil about it. Yeah, now he's all come out.
Seriously, get a nice pair of sandals. Get a nice pair of shoes. Get a like.
The aerodynamics of footwear for females to suit us better. I'm telling you, they've come up with
Cyrus, get a nice pair of sandals and you will be very happy with male sandals.
I've taken a month never to buy clothes or sandals or shoes so that the world gets rid of COVID. Everyone has to take a manat for something that's mine. And I shouldn't tell you because then the manat dies apparently. So I have to take a new one now. I'll do that in 5 minutes. But, you laugh at me and all that. But I'm telling you honestly, you haven't tried it. Don't knock it till you try it.
I have not tried your wife's sandals. But at the same time, I have... I know what difference it makes.
Amit
Doshi,
you're a 6 foot man, 100 odd kilos. Please tell me what sandals you wore. What was the female's name?
I have a pair of Adidas sandals of my own, which are fantastically comfortable. Your friend Costa, when he first started working with me last year or a year and a half ago, he decided to sit on like a stool and the stool collapsed under his weight and hit my foot. And I lost my toenail. Basically, the toenail was completely gone. And so I had to get sandals at that point in time. And so I got these Adidas sandals. They're wonderful. They're extraordinarily comfortable. If you want this is not an ad, and maybe it should be. But if you want the single best kind of most comfortable shoes that you could ever imagine, you should look for fabric-based shoes, like woolen shoes. I have a brand called Allbirds.
I don't want to be shut. I want to be open. I want to be the lungi of footwear. You know, it's got to be open. I'm an open guy. I don't want that. This is a tropical country. You know, I mean, it's too hot. Let's face it.
Okay, now so with the sandals.
Great sandals.
Get the open toe sandals.
I've got them. They're called Aisha sandals. They have actually got a French or German name on them, but I can I've looked down then, you know. I'm not a footwear hand guy. You know what I mean? Footwear hand guys are people who use their hands to put their footwear on. I don't do that. I need the footwear to go into my foot. They only have a relationship, foot and footwear. No hand, no elbow, no face.
How do you put your shoes on without your hands?
I don't wear shoes. I only have to wear them with the Bombay gym, which has started again. So I wear those Keds, which Manik Unwala gave me. One has come out completely. But once I enter the gym, I remove everything and I work out barefoot. Don't tell the others.
It's all good, sir.
All good. All good. Yeah. But you're not listening to my point. I'm saying that, you know, whether it's the salwar kameez, you've tried it. Now, being actors of really ill repute, we've had a lot of female clothing over the years, etc. And I found a lot of them, the apparel, I think they've got it wrong with the stereotype. You just decide that this suits women better. Have you worn a salwar kameez? You feel like a man. Like a man in a salwar kameez, Baba. It's beautiful.
A salwar kameez is basically the same as a churidar kurta, isn't it? I've worn many churidar kurtas.
No, I don't like the churidar kurta.
You have a kurta, which is, I mean, like salwar kurta.
But
is
you, just your hands have nothing to do. Once you have that, you know, you've got that drape, you know. I mean, that drape gives you royalty.
You want the scarf.
I want the scarf. I want that body language.
I
feel
scarf.
Like I'm one of the senators in Rome who's about to stab Caesar. You know, I'm like, where's Caesar? Where's Caesar? Ko bulao. Bulao Caesar ko sara. So for me, you know, there's all that. Anyway, look, I'm not trying to convert anyone. Please wear what you want to. And I know lots of males who are like, I'll never touch a female. Just think about it. The women pay more attention to design than we do. And they are more interested in both the comfort as well as the aesthetics. While, you know, I just feel they're 20% better at that than we are. So think about it. And there are plenty of hefty women who are the same size as us. I mean, maybe not you, but definitely Silvery and me. Yeah. Okay, I'm with you as well. I've been to San Francisco. I've seen them. They're back into jeans. Sorry?
I'd be very surprised to find women my size.
I've sat in a tube in New York with a lady who was so large, the tube was inside her by the end of the ride. And the fact is, they still wear really tight jeans. I mean, look at that. I mean, that's respect. Because when they get up in the morning, they ask 8 relatives to help them get inside that pair and another 18 to take them out of the pair at the end of the day. It's really tight. I hope this is not racist. I love America. But only Americans can do this. They just don't have any sense of the body. Oh, this is like, I'll just wear the jeans. That's it. And the rest of us are all the Asians and all the small people from different countries are looking at this lady like she's a monster. Like a titan. Or as we say in Gujarati, titan. I just think Titanic was one of my favorite words coming out of Regal when I heard this guy telling the other guy, yeah, Titanic, I didn't know picture. Chen. And once I heard Titanic, I just can't say Titanic again. All right. Enough of this nonsense.
Yes.
Let's move on. I don't have any footwear to show you, sadly. I wish I had made a mistake. Because if you saw it, then you would at least give me a 5%, 10% option of that what I'm saying is making some sense. Or you just think I'm nuts.
I understand what you're saying because you're finally wearing footwear which has been fitted for a human being and not for a wardrobe. That's it.
Though she's going to be the comedian, I'm doing the hardware. In any case, you were stumbling before the show started. We lost you in the middle. Then we got you back. Then you're asking Rishi, our tech guy, questions. I'm a little worried. That's like the cricketer or a basketball player on his last legs, you know, when he's hesitating to give a pass to the right guy. Those kind of things. You know when the old lion is ready to die. Okay, on a happy note, Silvery will take over. He's got so many good things to talk about.
Yeah, great things to talk about. But speaking of basketball, I thought we'd just talk about the basketball thing first. LeBron James is apparently about to become a billionaire, which is pretty big news.
Okay, one second. Billion is 100 million, right?
1,000 million.
Oh, 1,000 million, God.
Yeah.
That's a lot of money.
That is a lot of money. 100 million is not a shabby amount.
Yeah, Joe Rogan. Just any podcast says 100 million. 1,000 million.
That baby.
Yeah. This is an endorsement deal.
No, it's not an endorsement. So LeBron's invested in a lot of things, right? So I think one of the big things that he invested in was a pizza chain, which really blew up, right? So he was a very early investor, like invested like some $7 million or something like in a pizza chain, which is now worth like 50, 60, 100 times what it was worth when he invested in it.
Damn it. Missed that one as well. What's it called?
I don't remember. I don't remember. I do remember hearing about this. Basically, so most NBA athletes are investors these days, right? I mean, like, that's something that's become more and more prominent over there. It started because Golden State Warriors, right? And they're in Silicon Valley. And there were a couple of, different...
you've got guys from the past in baseball and all that, Alex Rodriguez, and before that also...
So Alex Rodriguez, yes.
No, being entrepreneurs, I'm saying.
Being entrepreneur. Dude, you have Michael Jordan. He owns the Charlotte Hornets. He's also a billionaire. Yeah. Blaze Pizza is what LeBron invested in. You have Magic Blaze Pizza.
I mean, it sounds horrible, and yet it's a success. I mean, who'd buy a pizza called Blaze? You need an Italian sounding name or a Mediterranean name or something like that. What the hell is Blaze?
Smoking
Joe sounds better.
Smoking Joe's is not bad.
The name is good.
It's a good name.
Okay, name by the
Blaze. Blaze sounds like an advertising firm. All right, welcome to Blaze. We'll take 15%. Blaze? It's going to be like Gabriella. It's going to have to... Then I don't know. Whatever. Billionaire because people like Blaze Pizza. Is he from Pawai? What's going on, Silvery? you expect a Pawai guy to come up with Blaze Pizza. I like this name. Building names. Well, while building names are lovely, no? Nobody speaks English properly, but they have names like, you know, Park View. go on.
A bunch of players from the Golden State Warriors did a bunch of Silicon Valley investing. So now that's become like a real, like, important part of how they spend money, right? So this Andre Iguodala guy is invested in like a whole bunch of different startups. I think he had money in Uber early and stuff like that as well, right? So I mean, like, it's just part of what these guys do. And
so did the chief of the NCP.
Who would the chief of the NCP be?
Come close. Sharad Pawar.
Oh.
Don't tell anyone.
Uber India or Uber?
There are a lot of people around the world who invested in Uber who we don't know.
Yeah.
You think it's true or is this a rumor?
It's quite possible. Again, Sharad Pawar money could very easily be there because the thing is Uber has done how much? Like billions of dollars in funding is taken, right? So if Sharad Pawar's 1 million is in there, it's very possible.
Blaze Pizza, Amit?
Blaze Pizza. Well, I mean, it's one of
even
the things.
Blase,
right?
Would be better.
Yeah, apparently he also has a stake in Liverpool FC. He also is part owner of
LeBron James
the Boston Red Sox.
Liverpool Football Club.
No, part owner.
Stake.
His stake, yeah. Part owner of the Boston Red Sox. Then Blaze Pizza is one of them.
He owns a baseball team and a football team, and he plays basketball. That's a sick man.
Because he can't own a basketball team now yet.
It's too expensive, is it?
No, he's still playing.
Oh, he's not allowed.
How can you?
They have ethics in America. We don't know all this. Jesus, too. I'm like, I called Sachin the other day. Should I just buy a team? I mean, who cares?
It's almost definitive that he will own a team once he retires, right? I mean, like, almost certainly he will own a team.
Okay, here's a question. Is he the basketball player of this generation? Is that...
Without a doubt.
Then is it not right that he is the highest earner in whatever way, the indirect earnings, maybe, or whatever?
He is he's probably also the highest in direct salary also. He's been making like...
Kobe,
Kobe retired in 2010.
Oh,
not
okay.
10. No, but not 10. Kobe, sorry, 13 or 14.
Kobe must have invested. He seemed like a smart guy.
100%. Kobe must have money as well. But again, the thing is that salaries increase every year in the NBA, right? Because as the... amount of money the teams, the way the NBA works is 50% of money goes to players, 50% of money goes to owners, right? And so the 50% keeps increasing every year. So what used to be a ridiculous salary, like, so 3 years ago, Chris Paul, who is in the finals right now for the Phoenix Suns, signed a contract which next year will pay him $44 million.
No, but what do you get before that? What's the jump?
No, so he's always been a highly paid guy. He's been like one of the best players in the NBA.
You don't give me the figure. What's the percentage?
So the thing is, the way the salary cap works is that you're allowed to pay a player what's called a max salary. A max salary is approximately 1/3 of your salary cap. Right, and that's the most you can pay anybody. So Chris Paul has been a max player probably for the last 10 years. So he's always bottom 1/3.
Oh. So this is IPL's copying this vaguely, having this ceiling. Ceiling option. Option in American. What's happened to America? It's fallen in my eyes.
No, so basketball has always had a kind of like this max because
regulatory system.
Yeah, in the sense that like LeBron James is probably the most underpaid player in the NBA, even though he probably makes 40 million plus a year. Right. But if you were to make a team and you were go to if you were to have an auction, you can pay whatever you want to. LeBron James would be part of your team. 100% somebody would pay him $100 million for the year. Right. If you are a if you are 100% somebody would pay him on the New York Knicks, the Los Angeles Lakers, somebody would pay him $100 million to become part of the team. But there is a restriction for that reason, so that you can't be, because if you have $100 million for LeBron James and you only have $20 million for everybody else.
Thank God he was born in America, not in India, because here he'd just be a chocolate. Part of a confectionery empire. Gems. We don't say James. We say gems. LeBron James. He's gems. He's very good. He's gems. Parsis will say gems for sure. LeBron James. Are you? LeBron James.
There's a person called Karan M in the chat, and he's saying that Blaze Pizza is really delicious. He's had it. And
I'm not saying it's not delicious. I just find the name. I mean, I think it works sometimes when you take a name it's almost opposite or doesn't make sense. So it's that, you know, breakout lateral thinking.
Maybe
style.
It's spicy pizza or something like that, because
could be,
Blaze,
it could also
like
just
fire.
Be like it could also just be targeted to a younger audience, maybe.
Maybe
it's
just
like
put
Blaze kind of sound like a younger word.
Somebody else has done the naming and everything else.
Oh, it's chipotle. It's pizza for it's like the chipotle of pizza. So, have you guys ever had chipotle in the US? It's a burger. It's a burrito.
Are you going to make us feel bad about our lives?
No. That
now we can't even Google in time because my net is down. No, it's not.
Your net better not be down. Otherwise, this would not work. Basically, it's like a buffet, right? So you go. When you're doing chipotle, you have a tortilla. You put some meat. You put some vegetables.
Oh,
you put whatever your toppings. Yeah. So you decide what you want, and then you give it to
that
guy.
I love
that
idea.
They heat it and then they give it back to you. So same thing for Blaze Pizza. You decide
that.
What toppings you want. Yeah. You give it to them. They heat it and give it back to you. That's what it looks like over here. At least the Google Wikipedia.
I love it.
Yeah.
There's a place like that in India already in Bombay called 1441 Pizzeria. They do exactly that. It's like Subway for pizza.
Where can I get this pizza?
1441.
It's actually really good.
Really good. Really good.
Yeah. I've only had it. It's in Parel. They have a Parel store somewhere.
But this is you got to be there. This is not a takeaway. So I mean
yeah, no, it's a takeaway.
Yeah.
It's a takeaway.
You got to see it and you smell it and that's how you. I used to do that with the ladies. Awkward moment.
Okay. Yes, very awkward.
We'll take a break. The sponsor was about to come in, and then we get into it. 1600. We had 1600. Oh, sorry. Go on.
No, 1441 is great. I've had it over here, like ordered in, and it's really good.
So it's one price. And then I can touch anything I want and put it on the pizza.
No, I think don't think that's how that would work. I think that's how the Blaze Pizza would work, because in the US they do one price for all this stuff all the time. In
it
India they're
that.
Going to, no, because in India then vegetarians get fucked, no?
No, exactly. So there is a
leave the veg non-veg aside, because that can be two departments or whatever the way.
It's not even just veg non-veg. Chicken versus a chicken topping versus a pork pepperoni topping.
No, over here
that's
they
a
have
McDonald's problem. You're giving me the four or five meat options. Give me the four or five vignettes,
exactly.
Whatever you call them.
So they have like a classic,
like Subway, right? Isn't Subway? Oh, no, they charge separately for everything. Right?
Different things. So yeah, different.
Exactly like Subway. Yeah.
I'll have to do a rejigging of the cabinet again.
I think you need to go and see what the thing is and come back to us with a report.
Close to my dinner time. You guys eat at 9. And the thing is, my daughters are in town to order the pizza. You know, I can't do it on my own.
Hey, man.
You know what my wife said? I don't know how many men out there are like me, but I know there are a few. She said, you went to from being dependent on your mom to dependent on me and dependent on your daughter. You are the ultimate loser. The ultimate. You know, because it's just never been a minute. You're clung to your mother's apron, then your wife's apron, and now your daughter, who's young, much younger than you, without her, you can't do anything.
I have the perfect segue thing about parenting. Okay, I'm going to share this video with you guys. And just tell me what you think. There was a man at a basketball game. At a baseball game in Phoenix, Arizona, that caught a ball that went off the field. I don't know what you call that. It's called a foul ball, if I'm not wrong.
Like a six in cricket.
Yeah, it's a foul ball. Yeah.
Huh?
You fall off, right? So basically, no. So what happens in baseball is it could be a home run also, but it could be a foul ball also. So if you like, there's this triangle, right? If you hit it within the triangle outside the park, it's a home run. If it goes outside the triangle, it's a foul ball.
Oh,
can you guys see my screen?
Let's take a look.
Yes, we can.
But it's happened many times, right? I mean,
no, but this is unbelievable.
It happens many, many times a game.
Yeah, yeah. But this is like once in a lifetime kind of thing. So Zach catches the ball. He almost drops his baby, then catches his baby and doesn't let the beer fall either.
So priority, ball first, beer second, baby third. All bow.
Just read this comment. Read this comment. Wait, did I just see this guy A, drop his baby, B, catch the ball, C, catch the falling baby, and D, not spill his beer. Grasshopper, that's some Jedi Kung Fu dad shit.
Hey, yeah, that's Jason Calacanis. I didn't realize that when I saw the story. He's the most prominent angel investor in the world.
Wow. Oh, really?
Yeah, he's the founder of Weblogs Inc., which was basically the first kind of blogging.
This is why I've kept a Gujarati in charge of us. His eye picked up the right thing. He ignored the entire baseball romance that you and me, hedonistic idiots that we are, we saw the beer, the baby, and the catch. He saw the investor. There's a small name. I didn't even look at it. Wow. Excellent.
I had seen the video, right? Antariksha sent it to me and I didn't realize it at that time. But when I saw it now, I was like, okay, that's that guy.
We're coming back to the guy, I'm saying when you go back home and the wife now, because you know, at the end of the day, you put the baby in peril for a couple of seconds. That might go the other way also, you know. You get a horrible beating for that. Because, you know, I mean, end of the day, you can't be effing around with a baby in your hand with a hard leather ball like that and a beer. Because he's got a beer and a baby, which in many cultures is also a little dangerous.
But again, super impressive, right? That he managed that.
It turned out good.
Oh, no. He was coordinated.
I'm doing once it turned out good.
His coordination was great, but I'm sure his judgment was probably not the best.
Ever. Yeah, that's true. That's true.
I remember we were playing a cricket match when I was in school. Harry Shield cricket match, Giles or Harris, whatever it was. And we were sitting, because you know how it is in Bombay, right? You sit in the middle of they make a small tent and you sit there. And in Azad Maidan, while you're playing a match here, there are 8 matches parallel and adjacent to you going on, right? So your back is third man to some other team, gully to the next team. You know, you're in those fielding positions without knowing it. So you're sitting on a small thing and suddenly a ball came right here. And this guy from my team, he caught it right in front of my face. Over in game over. Full-blooded shot from some parallel game. Yeah. It was an unbelievable moment. Luckily, he caught it right there. Like, exactly that Jedi feeling, the comment that your angel investor gave. It's exactly that. It was like, superb. Yeah. Really, we never became friends after that. Maybe he regretted it. Yeah. But I would put that down to luck a little bit. He must be good at catching and all that, but you know, with the one hand and the baby.
There are four things happening at the same time. That there is
baseball is like much bigger than cricket ball. It doesn't fit well. I mean, they grew up on it, so it's easier for them. They've played it more. But it's not an easy thing to catch without a mitt, you know?
It's not bigger than a cricket ball. It's about the same. It's heavier, but it hurts.
It really hurts.
Like a cricket ball, if you catch it with your bare hands, it doesn't really hurt that much.
You know where I played softball for the first time in my life? Working on a show for MTV in Bangalore in Mount Carmel College, all girls college. And they have a softball team and we shot it. And one of these chicks hit the ball hard and I thought, what is it? Nothing. Put my hand out exactly like that and my fingers came off.
Yeah,
all the machugari went out. Luckily, they all came to me and said, are you okay? And all this. That's like, always remember, play the wimp, not the hero. You can always win with the wimp. Yeah. That's a good story. But so can we reach out to Jason, whatever his name is? Now, of course.
Jason Calacanis? Calacanis.
Calacanis. No, but he's not the person who made the catch.
He's the person who made the tweet.
I made the tweet. Yeah, that's what. Yeah.
The catch guy is going to have trouble with his own family right now. He's going to send cash to us. But this guy could.
Well, yeah, he could, but he won't. There's a reason why he's the most popular or the most prominent angel investor in the world, right? He doesn't throw his money around.
Investing in stupid things. Is that what you're saying, Amit?
No, not saying that.
We have rubbish so much, there's no rubbish left. Why would you do
that? I was not attempting to rubbish the show at all.
Values will change. I'll get a light with a longer wire. I'll get a smaller dog. You know, the background will have like women dancing or whatever makes you happy. You know, or Jason's himself, his picture can be put at the back there with a big smile. But with him catching the ball, we can, you know, graphically alter all that. See, there are options.
There are things we can do.
And now no chance because my dog is started. Unbelievable. She doesn't like the investor. He's just a man. Sorry about that. Can't control female dog. You know what they're called. Sons of... Okay, move on next.
So another sports-related story is that a 21-year-old American sprinter by the name of Sha'Carri Richardson has been disqualified from participating in the Olympics, in 2020 Olympics, the Tokyo Olympics, because she tested positive for cannabis, which she says she smoked. Yeah, no, but she said she smoked it, you know, as a way to cope with her, with the death of her biological mother. And that's why she smoked it like a while before.
See, that's not going to hold WADA. It's not going to get into why you did it. Why you did it is never going to help.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay, you can say, but they always say I took cough medication because every cough medication has PEDs in it. The question here is that this is a non-PED. It doesn't improve your performance really. I mean, it could slightly because it helps your mind sometimes. But that was the argument. But they've gone and classified it as a drug and under WADA. And that's the way it is. The poor thing. Yeah. Because it was a big battle between her and this other girl. They're the two champs of the sprint. And everybody was hoping that they'd meet in the classic final in Tokyo. That's not going to happen. But it's really sad. She should have really smoked it up if she was going to get disqualified. She just had like 1 gram of marijuana. I mean, it's like Bill Clinton having oral sex and no more. Oh, I'll stop here, because I'm the president. What the hell? You saw what happened after that? He must have had an orgy. He should have had an orgy. Today he probably does because he regrets it so much. Whatever happened to Monica Lewinsky, by the way?
She's a very prominent author these days. And supremely intelligent.
I'm sure like, she is. It just sounded funny.
But it's incredible how, she's phenomenal on, it's amazing how she's turned her entire perception around. I get that you hadn't heard of what she's doing these days, but.
Oh, I think I heard that she wrote something, but she didn't take it seriously. I didn't think of her as, the next big thing in literature.
She's Booker Prize really...
winning author or Nobel Prize winning author.
No, so she's not really a writer, like a fiction writer. I think she's more of like she writes opinion pieces and those kinds of things.
Pieces.
Op-ed pieces and stuff like that. She's she does a lot of stuff on Twitter as well where she comes off really smart. So I was really impressed. I didn't know anything about her except for the scandal, right? And in some ways, when I first kind of started following her on Twitter and stuff like that, I was like, wow, this woman's amazing.
It's like being a baby. Your entire life will be defined by one event, but you know, babies, till they become older, that's it. You're a baby, so that's your event. And you're this is that. I feel a little bad for that.
It is terrible for that, right?
Than just that one event, for which he was probably more victim, with due respect. The old man knew what he was doing.
Of course, 100%. 100% she was a victim. We know this now, right? We know that Clinton was a predator. Like, I mean, like, you know, I politically, I like the guy, but we know that he was not.
Yeah, but if it's your daughter or relative, it's a different story altogether. That's why my warning to all women is stay away from politicians and actors and comics and angel investors. I don't trust those guys. What the hell's wrong with that guy? You know what I mean? Why did he send us money? He should have already been replying to us by now. 5 minutes have passed. My phone is here. It's not ringing. Jason! All right. Sorry.
I think we're going to take a break and then we can start up again.
Okay, we'll take a break. In the meantime, if you're an investor and you want to put a little money, and we're not looking at lots, into a podcast to redeem that podcast and make it justified to be on air or on the internet, then we are the people for you. Our menu card is with Amit Doshi. Please call him up anytime after 9 in the morning and before 2:30 the next day. Amit, you sleep at about 2, right?
In the morning?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Why not?
What the hell? If they're going to put money in, you wake up and take the call.
Yeah, I will take the call. That's why I said anytime's fine.
You don't have to tell them that back here in India, we don't have some wild parties to go to. The bars are closed. And Uddhav Thackeray is saying we'll stay in level 3 till the next Olympics. Forget Tokyo, wherever that is. That's something we should bring up. By the way, is the break over? I wasn't paying attention.
Break is over.
Okay. Yep. This break is like my career. You don't even know when it happened and it's just gone. That's it. All right. Okay, now you've got another video, right? You said we got two spectacular videos.
Yes, there's one more video. I'll share this with you guys. So there's a kid who has recently went viral, like over the last week or so, went viral and has now become a mascot for the local police in Dharamshala in Himachal Pradesh.
But you're showing it, right?
Yeah, I'm just showing it. I'm just showing it right now. So this is the video. Okay, this kid is just telling people to wear their masks, dude.
But somebody smack him. He's got a stick in his hand.
Because he saw cops doing the same thing, and he was like, I want to help the cops out because they are doing all this, telling people to wear masks, but people are not following protocol.
What happened to passing the IPS? Everyone wants the easy way out. Become a stick and just, you know, become a cop.
I mean, it's a little kid.
But it's so sad. I'm just ignoring him. That's just because he's small.
No, everybody's ignoring him because they're assholes.
So one or two have been nice. They patted him on the back. One may have been a pedophile, but the other one seemed normal. I don't want to point fingers, but
there's one person later who's really rude, and he like tries to grab the stick. It seems like grab the stick out of the little boy's hand. That's really rude. But just the heart of this kid is just so nice. And
if the police did things like that, I would really be a better citizen. You know, instead of talking gruffly to me about my dogs and things like that, if they had a young kid telling me nicely, can you please go back in, sir? We're all under this, you know, pandemic pressure, jo bhi hai. I think most of us would respond really better. They really should try communicating. I mean, I'm not saying use kids. It sounds like exploiting that poor child. We can stand there like a poor man's Luke Skywalker with some stupid plastic thing in a third world country with no dream for a real full-fledged fantasy. And then being bullied by everyone who passes. But I just think there's a lesson in communication. Because, see, what would you do, Silvery, if a kid like that spoke to you? Wouldn't you, like, I mean, it'd be a little charming, right?
Man, absolutely, yeah. Very charming, exactly. I would absolutely, like, I would obviously apologize because hopefully the reason I'm not wearing a mask is because I forgot to wear it and not because I just don't want to wear it.
Oh, you just tell him that anyway.
Yeah, I was just apologizing.
Even a really short man might be charming, you know, because...
Just why are different. All these people out in the world without a mask right now? Like, I don't understand that.
Go to Dharamsala because you want to remove that mask culture from your mind. We had another investor whose name I will not take, who was in Dalhousie, for example, and he was saying that a lot of people, you know, that fear is gone. It's like you've gone to another geography and that fear goes out with coming to the new geography, crossing the Rubicon.
That's not how the world works, and that's not how COVID works, and that's not how viruses work.
But it's human nature. I totally accept it. It's human nature. It's like you've come to safety, and they're dying to do that, and hence they're there. It's all tourists.
If you go and stay in like a freaking cabin on the mountain, man, you can't like go out in the market without a mask.
You're that going just to seems sooner like, or later.
Yeah.
But the later is better when once we're all vaccinated, so we can go into the world.
Vaccinate people with 6 vaccines as soon as possible. The human nature is going to take over. There's nothing we can do. All the police will clash and the army will clash and they'll just be bloody and terrible. There's no hope. Yep. People need to walk.
With the number of people...
People need to absolutely. Walk.
But the thing is,
I'm just saying it's human nature. It's like when people have less economic influence, you keep cash lying around and then the money goes away. You've got to take a little bit of that blame because, you know, why are you tempting human nature? You know, human nature is very fallible. You should have that low level of human nature expectancy.
Listen, I understand what you're saying, and I no one thinks less of humanity than I do, right? I mean, like, I really.
This is the kind of thing I like to hear on the podcast.
But at the same time, the thing is that when the selfish thing to do is to wear a mask. Right? It is selfish to wear a mask in this sense because I want to be out in the world. I want everybody wants to be out in the world. And I was talking to my brother, right? And everything is open in America right now. Everything is freaking open because they got vaccinated. So, everybody's vaccinated.
But they are wearing or not wearing? With many places, they're not wearing the
mask anywhere because they're vaccinated.
Yeah.
There are people with that. And we're a larger country. It's going to take us longer to get vaccinated levels. And they were also till April. Everybody was wearing masks only over there. April, May. In April, May, this stuff started.
There are states like Georgia and Texas and all that. It's been really hard to enforce.
There are places where it is, right? But for the most part, in most of the West Coast, East Coast, which is where most of the people we know are, in most of those places...
The others don't count, Amit Doshi. The others don't count because they're rednecks, so I have different...
No, they don't. But I mean, like, why should... I mean, the thing is that, in my mind, the goal is to get out of the house. The goal is to be out and about in the world, right? There was a thing that came out from Maryland just yesterday. In the state of Maryland, there was not a single fatality. There were, I think, some 300 people died from COVID in Maryland in the month of June. Not one of them was vaccinated. Like, didn't even have a single dose. Anybody with even a single dose did not die.
There'll be exceptions, otherwise they'll start attacking everybody else. But your best chance, let's say, but you're playing the percentage correctly by having the vaccine and the double one.
Just get vaccinated. I mean, until you're vaccinated, wear the mask. I mean, like, the shit ain't rocket science. once you're vaccinated, you don't have to wear the mask as much. And once and until you're vaccinated, just wear the mask. And so that we can all get on with our lives. I'm sick of this. I've been home for 14 months now.
Really?
Sorry, I just, yeah.
No, that's good. It's good. You must. This is a therapy show. In fact, we're going to keep it open for everybody in the AMAs to also vent. There has to be more venting in this country. If we vent more, we'll be better people. We don't vent enough and it stays in like a cancer and it, you know, fosters and, sorry, festers. And then before you know it, you can't, you know, it's like a soda pop. So I don't want that to happen, Amit. I want you to tell me the truth. Whatever you're feeling, just, you know, we don't have an investor yet. When we do, you shut up. But till then, please vent. Please vent.
It just, I don't understand. I don't understand people like this, right? I just don't get it.
It's a small term solution. So the way I see it is that a human nature starts, small term solution. Let's go here, escape this problem. It's solved temporarily for a little while. Let me breathe. And that's all I'm thinking. I'm not thinking long term. And I don't, and I think I'm okay whether I've had one vaccine or whatever. Because the geography in Himachal is better. The cases are much less and it's a much safer place to be in. Especially, the other thing with Indians is that they think if you go towards the mountains, you go up, you know, as you go higher in altitude, the chances of COVID are a little less. I don't know if this is a true theory, but if you talk to people, they have this self-belief. We'll escape towards the mountains and there the COVID is less. In the cities and in some of the towns, big C towns, if you want to call them that, that's where all the trouble is. This is so again...
COVID density is related to population density. That's not exactly this. Rocket science, but they're in a freaking market right now.
But when you, 50% off, we're Indians. You give me that sign and I break through.
What was the Manali thing also you sent, right? There were like apparently thousands of people in Manali.
One second. Manali, exactly.
The place, just the place. So there's a term for this now. People, tourist destinations are seeing like a massive influx, especially in India, like hill stations and all. Huge influx because people have been stuck at home. So now there's a term for this called revenge travel, where people like as a vengeance are going out. Okay, man, I've been stuck at home. Stupid, why?
Because COVID like and all. We said. Yeah, we have the same conception as the title they've given us. But it is, I totally agree. Yeah. I thought of it myself. My daughter and I have chatted about it. Can we go on a holiday? Where can we go? You know, thinking from that point of view, does Thailand have this thing? Does Vietnam have that thing? And you're just thinking, I can go to a bubble for a little while where nothing is there and life is normal. I can eat and drink and walk and do normal things for a week or so. So that thought is there. We don't act on it. A, because we're scared. We're scared about ourselves. And B, we're scared about others as well. But, you know, whatever. I don't know why we're scared. As you said, there's nothing great about humanity. Why do we care? I mean, look at the England cricket team. I mean, you know, three guys got it. Now they've got a whole new team playing against Pakistan. The guys don't know each other. The Pakistanis don't know any of them. So, you know, it's all the conversation is in one syllable. It's all that. You don't know the guy by the name. Just right. I guess I've lost you all with the English cricket team's problem.
Yeah,
flying word that rhymes with duck, luck, muck, truck.
I don't know. I'm paying attention. You gave me 6 minutes on the NBA. I can listen to 5 minutes on cricket.
No, but this is not about cricket. So, this is about the fact that they panicked. That the English cricket board panicked and said, "Okay, three guys have it. So let's just change the whole team for this next series." So literally, they've literally got like two known names: James Vince and Ben Stokes, and nobody else. Just dropped nine people in, all debutants. They're playing right now, and I'm doing this show instead of watching the game. Yes, sir. What do you? Slack shocking.
So these are the pictures that Amit was talking about. This is currently in Manali. This is like over the last couple of days, where the crowds like this are coming to Manali.
These are the guys who survived the coomb and went straight here. Yeah. Ah, America was never. Off I go. Man,
man, this is never ending. This crowd. Oh man.
How in a country of 1.3 billion, are you really? It's you really think 1.3 billion have that kind of discipline and zeal to follow law and order and rules and regulations? I mean, how much you need? How many idiots? If 5% of our population or 3% of our population are complete morons, it's mayhem. 1% still mayhem.
1% is more than enough. Half a percent. 1.1% is enough, right?
There you go.
0.1% of a billion and a half is a million and a half, right?
There you go. And here's the secret. Here's the secret. It's actually more of them who are idiots. Let me tell you. Much, much more. This number is wrong, my mathematical friends.
Yes, it is.
Okay. Shall we move to the AMAs or do we have any stories left?
We have to talk about the reshuffle that is happening with the Modi government right now.
We must.
Yep. So some 43 new cabinet members have been basically appointed.
Is it 43 have been appointed to new posts or are these 43 fresh ministers?
Well, most of them are old posts which have been replaced so that you've been shunted out and shunted in.
Exactly.
So it's basically
like Babul Supriyo, for example.
So it actually is shuffled.
Yeah.
Yeah. Babul Supriyo lost his job. Ravi Shankar Prasad lost his job. And Prakash Javadekar lost his job. These are three people who watch my show. And, okay. and other three BJP faces I like. And now they've gone. So I'm going to really struggle here. So I'm going to really struggle.
The media yesterday figured out a very interesting way of figuring out who was in and who was out or this cabinet thing, right? So whoever outside, all their houses are in Delhi, right? All these ministers' houses at least were in Delhi or whatever. Yeah. And so whoever's house had like a lot of people gathered outside with flowers and
clearly,
like congratulating. Yeah, yeah. So those are the people who were being elected. And people whose house were like silent and like a pura sumsan, no noise coming out. Those were the guys who were getting fired.
So a politician who is inducted in the cabinet, including a new health minister, can have lots of people and no social distancing. Just the law of the land. Good to know. Yeah. Excellent. Yeah. But Dr. Harshvardhan is he's already been once pushed around by the PMO a little while back when he was health minister the first time round. Suddenly disappeared into oblivion. Then he was brought back, and one way of looking at it is scapegoat. Someone has to take the blame. It sounds like very bold decisions because the old guard. These are the guys from 2014. The names I mentioned were all from 2014. So that's your top rank and file. And you generally, in no MNC does the old guard go in one shot. That's a huge cleaning of the broom. From a business, and you look at politics as business. It just won't happen unless it's extreme situation. Where you churn them all out. And that's almost what's happened here, except Nirmala Sitharaman, from what I can tell. Hmm. So, yeah. And what do you think? You think it's a good, positive move? Because you always talk about young blood in sports, politics, business. Well, here's young blood now. Youngish blood. Very youngish.
I would we'll see how it goes. It's just...
You're so prejudiced, you can't find good in anything.
Okay, I can't.
I like it.
I cannot. Right now, we will have to see how it goes. There have been so many disasters, right? So many self-calls, so many stupid things that have been
done. No, but look at it this way. Part two of the COVID thing, just our performance. Part one, I think we weren't so bad because we were caught unawares. Good. They did what they could. And in most states, Kerala did decently well. Maharashtra did decently well. Punjab. But when you come back to part two, there's heads on the block there. Is there not? Because the infrastructure should have been there. Why were we so complacent? Why did it still take so long after they started the lockdown at end March, early April to get things in place? And, why is the vaccine a distribution issue? Forget shortage. Distribution is different from shortage. Why is that still an issue? That's logistical. That's how you set up a production in our line of work. That's your job, to just distribute things correctly.
It's a series of screw-ups, right, that have occurred. It's not just COVID. Even before COVID, there were a whole bunch of screw-ups that were occurring after the other. The thing about the BJP that was supposed to be different from the Congress, right, is forget the... it's very difficult to do that, but let's put aside the bigotry aspects of things or the communal aspects of things.
Have to be so apologetic to find some good. There's good to be found in anything. So that's okay.
The thing is that you expected competence, right? That's what we were expecting from Modi and Shah.
Right. That was sold right from the beginning. We'll give you efficiency. And we'll get you progress. The word Vikas is thrown about a lot. Vikas was a friend of mine in school. He's done nothing with his life. Go on.
I also had a friend named Vikas in school who's done quite well in life, actually.
So there you go. BJP was right. So to give the devil its due, we were supposed to have a competent government, efficient government. And they gave us... No, and in part one, they shouted from the rooftops about how everything will be okay. And it was sort of okay. And then it wasn't okay. And then he's no Fauci. Harshvardhan is no Fauci. He said some silly things.
They gave us demonetization in part one here. That is a...
I'm talking about part one of the COVID thing. My mother had to stand in those lines. I'm not forgiving them for that. That was terrible. Yeah. I was out of town and she had to actually go herself. And it's ridiculous.
Yep. That's
just what they did to old people. Ah! That's it.
Yeah, I quit. That's what I'm saying. So
Parsi Sinha Zindabad.
There's a very interesting comment in the chat which says that Pradeep Pillai says that average age of the cabinet has come down to 58 from 61. How does that really make a difference? Which is absolutely true.
This is again, I'm not being devil's advocate, but when you do this in football or the NBA or one of these things, it is literally 2 year difference. If it's a younger team, German team is an older team, English team is a younger team. Difference is like 19 months the average age. So 61 to 15 sounds funny, but it actually is a step in the right direction if you're looking at let's get younger people in. You can't expect them to go from 61 to 34.
You take it as a percentage of the overall age. You have to look at like how much younger did they get from a rating perspective. I mean, you can't compare it in absolute years because when you go from 24 to 21, that's much younger than when you go from 61 to 50.
It is not the ageism issue here so much as it is the fact that the old blood and the old guard has been kicked in the ass.
That's the thing.
The young blood has come in more like, it's like, okay, now I've acted. I've shown you that I've acted. Okay, I've taken harsh action. This is good leadership. We've not done well and I've taken action. So from a PR point of view, it's a skilled move in that sense for me.
It is a very skilled move. Because,
is it the right move? How can we answer that? Because they now have to perform with the new guys for us to know.
We'll have to see. But it is a very skilled PR move because it gives you the, if a third wave comes in, oh, we just got into, you know, we just took charge. And if a third wave doesn't happen, see how great we are.
Call the old guys back. But I'll tell you, I'm not joking. Ravi Shankar Prasad, I know he was giving trouble with Twitter. Not only has, you know, there's a party whip and you have to, leaving that aside, these are the kind of guys you can relate to. Prakash Javadekar, very witty, nice man. Nitin Gadkari. There are three, four of them who I would think would be able...
The Gadkari kind of person that you shuffled can, out.
No, he's not been shuffled out, but I'm saying these are the three, four faces in the BJP that I like.
Okay.
That appeal to me. And Babul Supriyo, I know he's not everybody's cup of tea, but he, you know, I've known him since MTV days. We were in touch here and there. And I felt they must be feeling really terrible because they are rank and file. They're like, if you look at old Sicily, I mean, this is your main guy, the made men, as we say in gangsta terminology. The made men never go. You know, I'm stunned that he took this thing because it'll either scare the crap out of everyone or there will be breed disloyalty.
I think that's bound to happen, right? I mean, like, you're... But I think that's one of the dangers in politics just generally, right? Like, how...
That is where power corrupts.
It does.
You see, in a sense that you feel you can do anything. And then slowly you break the morale without knowing it. Because when... history is replete with examples. When the alpha goes more alpha, then there's a blind. You know, Alexander became mad after some time. He just wanted to keep going forward. And the soldiers were like, are you nuts? Look how hot India is. Besides, look at the monsoon. We don't like this place. And the food sucks. Although our food is much better than Greek food. I don't know what the problem was, but we'll discuss that in another show.
Greek food is good too. Huh?
It is. What am I saying? I love Greek food. But my Greek food is the gyro or gyro sandwich. And you know, the New York guy used to peddle. Did you have those? I had a real taste for that.
Of course. Gyros are amazing, man. And there's a lot more tashiki. There's so much stuff in Greek food. Greek food
is probably
really
the best diet in the world, Mediterranean.
It is.
When you get to the AMAs, but if you get a dietitian on, I want to discuss that. Because the whole deal about drinking wine through their lives, moderately, seems to have really done well for a whole generation of people from a certain region. I mean, there's a lot of people. We're not talking about one village. So, yeah. Silvia, I hope you're having two glasses of red wine every day.
I will start.
No reply. No. You only should increase when you mention the hill stations, the beautiful hill stations of Kulu, Manali. You
that, that time is all there, right?
Yeah, exactly. It's all there.
So talk about wine and it's like, yeah.
Brocha and Doshi and their wine. How passe. Okay, are we doing AMAs?
Let's do AMAs.
So I got a 55 out. Yeah.
Ruben David asks AMA for Cyrus, your take on the new Ministry of Cooperation created ahead of the reshuffle, which is also being headed by Amit Shah. Do you know about this? So there's a new ministry formed.
This is 1984-esque, isn't it? The Ministry of Cooperation?
This is a whole new ministry. This is that we've never had before. And the headline right now in front of me is Ministry of Cooperation. Sorry?
This is Big Brother in the business world.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. This is crazy, man.
Well, let's see. Let's see how that pans out.
And it's being headed by Amit Shah himself. So he's going to be heading the Home Ministry and the Ministry of Cooperation.
Huh. And they're poles apart.
So the four ministries in 1984 were the Ministry of Truth, the Ministry of Peace, the Ministry of Love, and the Ministry of Plenty. This sounds suspiciously like one of those.
But the paradox is it's the Ministry of Cooperation, which also means if you do not cooperate, you know what I'm saying? this is a not so subtle message. Oh boy!
Yeah, because you have to cooperate. There is no non-cooperation.
Well, you know, it's like the state and the church. All along they fought in Europe in medieval times and beyond. State and church, they had to separate finally because you just couldn't manage the balance. And I'm thinking now also we've reached the point where, you know, democracy is going to fail completely because each institution is going to, one is trying to take over the other, at which point there is no sense of democracy.
What was the freedom? What was the thing in freedom during the freedom struggle? Was it called the non-cooperation movement?
Your audio is suddenly gone after you mentioned Ministry of Cooperation, and I'm not kidding.
Can you not hear me anymore at all?
No, I can hear you. But
Now
we can hear you.
No. I was just asking. What was the name of the thing during the freedom struggle? Wasn't it called the non-cooperation movement or something like that?
No, there was a non-cooperation movement. There was civil disobedience. No. Ask the old man. I was there. Both were there. Yeah, okay. Simon Commission. Everything. What do you want to know?
I'm just amazed. We go from a non-cooperation movement to the Ministry of Cooperation.
Amazing. Well, swings and roundabouts. Let's see what happens. Yep. One thing about India is our business community, whether you like them or loathe them, have always been very enterprising and independent to some extent. And they cannot, they can't kowtow. If they kowtow to we're finished. Commerce, which is our strong point, you're taking away our strong point. It's okay if you take away one of the, with due respect, cultural oldies that we have. I won't mention anything, and nothing really happened to the country. But you can't take away our enterprising, the entrepreneurial spirit. Which is why Amit Doshi started the podcast, for example. And then, there's millions of others. That's a bit sad, scary.
Yeah.
All right. Off we go then.
Next one.
Amit, you got family in America, right? So, Silvery, pack your bags. Off we go.
All right.
We leave tomorrow. Next one. Guys, I have to join an Iranian phone call.
Okay. This is the last couple then. The next one comes in from Pradeep Pillai again. He says, hey, Cyrus and team. Question for Cyrus. Can you share your experience getting interviewed by Karan Thapar a decade ago on his iconic show Face to Face for BBC? He addressed you as India's greatest talker. I've actually seen the interview, and dude, you are amazing in the interview, I must say.
2002, 3, 4 is many years ago. I was really not used to that level of professionalism. They call you 10 times and then they come and do throat fittings just for an interview. He had a big budget then, of course, on BBC. And it was great. I can't remember much about it. I always remember the other things. I was trying to find butter chicken late night because I couldn't take the flight back, and the hotel, the guys, he didn't make a butter chicken. They called it something else. I remember that was a big issue. And it turned out to be butter chicken, but they called it something else. And he said, what's the butter chicken then? There's some other name for it.
I've seen it at a bunch of five stars. They call it masalam instead of calling it butter chicken.
So he tried to explain to me that Sarji was same, but butter chicken didn't call it. What did they butter chicken? What did they call it? Chicken butter masala, whatever. There are 2-3 variations of the same name, but it was like this. It's a totally different name. And so I was, that memory I do have. Because it was late by the time I came back, and there was only 3-4 things available, even for a five star. Five stars also have a limited menu between 11 and 11:30 and 4:30 in the morning. So, these are the problems of the elite. Also there's COVID and people dying and no jobs and poverty and corruption and all that. And casteism, communalism, sexism, ageism. But there's also butter chicken being called by different names and you're being teased about it. That's not good. Yeah, Karan Thapar, good fun. He had that bow tie. I couldn't have been more. I don't know. Finally, they gave me a black T-shirt to wear and all that because I was so badly dressed. And the paradox between his, sense of style and sartorial sort of aesthetics and mine. I must have had chappals on and all. I can't remember. But it was in Delhi, so they flew me down, business class, put me up in a hotel. Short. He was very sweet. He was really nice. But don't ask me about the interview because I can't remember any details.
Okay. No worries. Next one comes in from Harvest Kasar. He says, hello guys, what is your take on the new Rolex advert on Roger Federer? It is completely pro Federer in nature. Is that the right thing to do for such a big brand?
What does it say? He's been a Rolex endorsee for years.
I haven't seen the ad. I don't know what the ad is. But if you have somebody who is a big athlete endorsing your brand, the brand has to endorse the athlete in the as well, no? It can't just be like if Federer is a Rolex guy and Nadal is a, I don't know, what's another big watch brand? A Tag Heuer.
Titan?
Tag Heuer guy, right? Nice. Yeah, so if one is a Rolex, so of course there's going to be a pro Federer Rolex ad, no? Why would it be anything but that? What are they going to do? They're going to say great things about the guy who's
also, let's face it, Federer's moved to another level of consciousness. It's not about winning or losing. He's on his last legs. He's just out of Wimbledon. He's so iconic that, why would he hold it against the brand for promoting him? I can't understand that. It's like Mount Everest now. It's different. It doesn't just belong to India or Nepal or something. It's Mount Everest. So Federer, we can all claim him. you reach a point where LeBron James or whatever, he goes beyond his club or his whatever. You just reach a status where you're for everyone. So I'm okay. Even though we should have seen the ad before we commented because we sound like Philistines, but we don't really care. Until we have an investor, this is the quality of the program. It'll go down after the investor, I guarantee you. Yeah. Okay, can we take one quick one? And then it's a Parsi evening for me.
Sure. First, Deepak Gupta has a comment saying Ministry of Cooperation is for cooperative industries and businesses as per official news.
Okay. So, okay. All right. So I might have been technically wrong, but it's still a dumbass name to give a ministry because you're setting yourself up for this only. It sounds like a...
It's a lazy name. It's like, why have a thought?
Yeah.
Cooperatives ko control karne ka, let's just call it cooperative industry. And then,
so call it the Ministry of Cooperative Industries. Why are you calling it the Ministry of Cooperation? It is incorrect to say that because it means something else.
Why can't you say Ministry of Halla Gulla or something so that we at least pay attention? The name should have some consequence. I'm not happy with this. It sounds like a bad bank. Yeah. All right. But when we take back everything we said against it, we are all for it. We are pro it and we endorse it. Here's our stamp. Ding.
Except for the name. They should call it the Cooperative Industries Ministry, yeah. Not the Ministry of Cooperation.
I would like just a normal Indian name like Ranjit. The Ministry of Ranjit.
But then they'll have to give it they'll have to give it like one of those AR for a stands for something. And then I forgot what those words are called. Like R for
we don't have a Federa to endorse the cooperative industry. We'll just take Ranjit. It's done.
Ranjit.
Okay, guys, can we do one last one?
Yes. Okay, sure. Really this one comes in from Spandan Bhattacharya. He or she says, but I think it's the responsibility of the citizens now to ensure that the third wave isn't deadlier than the second wave. People need to be responsible enough. Blame other people. What are your thoughts on that?
No. So I blame other people for being assholes. And I'm sorry, Saris, I'll let you finish after that.
Yeah.
I blame other people for being assholes, but it is the government's responsibility to make sure that policies are set in a way that we avoid a third wave. You cannot blame the people who get COVID.
Go on.
No, that's it. That's all I got to say.
Push the vaccine, man. Don't waste time with human nature. People are going to go on holiday and going to do things. I mean, you can just see it. You can just see the traffic increase. Everybody's got their mask sided style on the chin. And I have a reason for that. I have a double chin, so I need that protection, something to hold it up because it's heavy and weighs me down gravitationally speaking. So leaving that aside, I just don't trust human nature. Vaccinate, go past that 60% mark or whatever, and then hope to God that we're okay.
We should. Right. I hope we are.
All right. From the Ministry of Cooperative Affairs, it's me saying bye-bye to all of you. Love you and see you tomorrow morning. But love you was unnecessary. I don't know why I said that. Sounds like a Miss India competition. I've won. I love everybody. And I will heal the children and save the people and poverty to all countries. No, not poverty. The opposite. All right. Bye-bye. Amit is...